I'm moment, did you forsake me? Not for a moment, did you forsake me? After all, you are constant. After all, you are only good. After all, you are sovereign. Not for a moment will you forsake me. Singing in the dark, whispering a promise, even when I could not hear. I was held in your arms, carried for a thousand miles to show. Not for a moment did you forsake.
In your everlasting. Seeing that, we can then believe that you are able to take us forward and that there is nothing to fear, for you are sovereign through it all. Through all the joy, through all the trials of our life, you are sovereign. You still sit on the throne, no matter what we're going through. And so we trust in you. So we asked that our hearts and our minds remain open as we hear the word, and that we would enjoy this fellowship with our own families, in our own homes, and have that fellowship and just be encouraged by your word amidst all the fears and chaos in our life. May you bless the message as it comes, so that we may be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Over there. All right, welcome to the Calvary Midland. Hopefully you guys are doing some great social distancing. We're here social distancing, Brandy and I, as we put together this study. And so I just want to take a break from the book of Acts right now and just really try to look for some encouraging messages to share as we're in this uncharted territory, kind of not knowing how this is going to turn out, but knowing that the Lord's still in charge. And so I wanted to put this study together and share it with you and your family and hopefully bring encouragement in an uncertain time. And so let me go ahead and pray and we'll get started. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for those who will receive this message. And I just pray that you would be with us, Lord, and the fear and anxiety that can come in times like this, and that we know that you're good, that you have a good purpose and a good plan. And so I pray that we'd come back to your word, draw encouragement from it, and help us to move forward in you. I just pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as you open your Bibles to Galatians chapter 6, would you travel with me to a magical place called Kona, Hawaii? And don't worry about the coronavirus. We're only going there in our minds. We'll be fine. Now, Kona, Hawaii is the western side of what is commonly referred to as the Big Island. This region is famous for its coffee and for its snorkeling, for sport fishing and sunsets. It's a beautiful area that enjoys a ridiculous 300 days of sunshine a year. And if that weren't enough, you can even swim with dolphins off the coast if that's your thing. However, every year on a Saturday in October, Kona is overtaken by some 2,000 individuals from around the world who are not interested in coffee or snorkeling. They're not there for sport fishing or for sunsets. And they won't be there for sunshine or swimming, at least not swimming with dolphins. Instead, these individuals will be there to compete in one of the most difficult races in all of sports, the Ironman World Championship. These elite athletes will seek to complete a rigorous course that is made up of three distinct events. The first event is a 2.4-mile open water swim in Kailua Bay. Next comes a scenic but long 112-mile bike ride. And the final event is a full 26.2-mile marathon. The mental, emotional, and physical strain will be unimaginable. Incredibly, the top male competitors will finish the race in a little under 8 hours, while the top female finishers will complete the race course in under 9 hours. And with that said, it should come as no surprise that many of the competitors who start this grueling race will never finish. But for those who do complete the race, once they cross the finish line, the race is over and they can relax, or more likely pass out. Now, if you're like me, the Ironman World Championship has no appeal whatsoever. However, though you and I most likely will never physically compete in an Ironman World Championship, if we are Christians, then we are competing in a race. In a very real sense, each and every believer has entered a spiritual Ironman competition. And though the Christian race may not be as physically demanding as the Ironman World Championship, it is much more strenuous emotionally, mentally, and spiritually for one distinct reason. You never know when your Christian Ironman is going to end. You see, the Ironman World Championship in Kona, Hawaii is a set course of 140.6 miles. But in this Christian endurance race that we call following Jesus, we have no clue how far we must swim, bike, and run with our Lord. We have no idea what kind of crazy things we're going to endure, like the coronavirus we're going through right now. And because the total distance is unknown to us, because we don't know how far we're going to be expected to go, there is always this reoccurring temptation to quit, to give up, to drop out of the race. And because this temptation to drop out of the spiritual Ironman is something that each Christian faces, and I think in our uncertain times, we're seeing that clearly, I want to look in depth this morning at Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Now, I must confess that Galatians 6, 9 is my life verse. I've tried for other life verses, but this is the one the Lord gave me. It can be found below my name on every email I type, and it's the primary verse that the Lord brings me back to time and time again. So please follow along as I read it. Galatians 6, 9. Paul writes, "And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart." For our study this morning, I've divided this verse up into six sections with the emphasis of encouraging each of us to keep running the race no matter what's going on in this world. We're going to look first of all at teamwork, then courage, then focus. Fourthly, we'll see patience, and then promise, and finally, endurance. And I'll go back over those as we move through. But let's move into our first section, and that's teamwork. In this section, I want to focus on the first three words of our verse, "and let us." The word "and" here lets us know that Galatians 6:9 is a continuation of thought from the previous verses. So to get some context, would you look back at Galatians 6, verses 7 and 8? There Paul writes, "Do not be deceived, God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. And for he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, and he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life." And so we have this farming symbolism that Paul often uses, and that would have been familiar to people there in the ancient world, but it's this idea that whatever you sow, you reap. That if you plant, you know, let's say watermelon seeds, you're expecting a crop of watermelons. Or you're planting corn, you're expecting a crop of corn. That whatever you put in, that's what you get out. And so it's this idea of this farming that we see as we move into verse 9. You see, what Paul is doing here is he's speaking of a spiritual crop that we're seeking to sow and then reap. That as believers there in Galatia, the original audience of Paul, and by extension to us, he's encouraging all of us to keep sowing in the Spirit so that we might reap that spiritual crop. So let's look again at these first three words of Galatians 6:9. We read, "and let us." And I like that, this "let us." This is a reminder that Christianity is a team sport. It's not about me, it's about us. And this is vitally important for us. And I think especially in this time of, you know, social distancing, and this time of kind of being isolated from one another, it's vitally important that we remind ourselves that we're not just individuals, that we're a body. maybe a little bit more challenging for us now as we can't connect on Sunday morning like we usually do for this time being. So even finding ways to text or to call or to email people, to use social media to remind ourselves that it's an us, not a me. You see, we often get tempted to quit the race when we think we're the only ones running. And it's good to know that even the greats of the Bible struggled with this. Even the heroes of the faith struggled with thinking they were the only ones. One of the most notable examples comes from the life of the prophet Elijah. So would you take a moment and turn to the Old Testament book of 1 Kings? I want to look at 1 Kings chapter 19. I'm going to look at verses 11 through 18. So 1 Kings 19. And as you're turning to 1 Kings 19, Elijah has just come off really the greatest victory of his life as a prophet. He defeated the prophets of Baal there at Mount Carmel. But then he's on the run from Jezebel, and he's very overwhelmed by the situation. And he had this high, and now he's kind of in the valley, spiritually speaking. But as we move into verse 11 of 1 Kings 19, the Lord said to Elijah, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore into the mountains and broke the rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice." And so it was, when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entrance of the cave. And suddenly a voice came to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he said, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts." And that's true. And he says, "Because the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with a sword." And that's also true. But the last thing that he says is not true. He says, "I alone am left, and they seek to take my life." And so the struggle that Elijah is going through is he's forgetting that it's an us, and he just thinks it's a me. And he's struggling with that. And that may be, again, where we are right now. As we begin to be isolated socially and kind of out of our normal routines and kind of life as we've built it, and what happens, we may feel like we're all alone. And so it's a reminder from the scriptures that many men and women of God have felt this way. But I love what, as we continue on in 1 Kings 19, the perspective that the Lord gives, starting in verse 15, "And the Lord said to him, 'Go return your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, anoint Hazael as king over Syria. And you shall anoint Jehu, the son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, you shall anoint as prophet in your place.'" And so there's at least one. Elisha's not the only one. There's this Elisha that's going to follow him. It says, "And it shall be whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, Jehu will kill. Whoever escapes the sword of Jehu, Elisha will kill." And then here is verse 18. "Yet I have reserved 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." And so the Lord's reminding Elijah here, hey, there's 7,000, 7,001, if we count Elisha there, who are these individuals who are still focused on him. And so as we think about our own lives, and even in the challenges that we're facing right now on planet Earth, there are many millions of believers on this planet. There's a whole lot of us, and we need to remind ourselves of that. And it's been pointed out to me lately when I've kind of had my own pity party about the situation, is that we need to think about others and get our minds off of ourselves and focus on others and what's good for others. So reach out to others in this time. See how they're doing and encourage them. Elijah had focused on himself, and he was kind of inward. And so what happened is that it was just drying him up inside. He needed to get his eyes onto others and do the work of the ministry God had called him to and find that encouragement there. All right, for more on this subject of the reminding us that we are in us, would you turn now back to your New Testament? This time, we want to turn to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, looking at some familiar verses in verses 9 through 13, Sermon on the Mount. And as you're turning there to Matthew chapter 6, I want you to please pay special attention to the teamwork aspect. Notice that as the Lord gives his disciples and us this model prayer, that the focus is on the ours and the us's and the we. Matthew 6, verses 9 through 13, "In this manner, therefore, pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And so as we look at that, as we focus on that, the us and the our and the we, it's a reminder that we're not running this race alone. But it doesn't stop there. Not only do we have fellow Christians who are teammates, we have the ultimate teammate as well. We have a teammate who comes to live inside of us, one who has the power to propel us to the finish line, no matter how long or how difficult the race is. And this ultimate teammate that I'm referring to is the person of the Holy Spirit. See, the Lord Jesus had the following to say about the teamwork of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, when he shared with his disciples these words. He says, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And if you need this extra encouragement, kind of remind yourself about the Holy Spirit and who he is and what he does, I would encourage you during this time when you're at home and social distancing that you read the Gospel of John. As you get to the last part of the Gospel of John, we talk about the Lord Jesus shares about how this Holy Spirit will come and he's going to be a comforter and he's going to be the one to encourage the disciples and help them finish the work. And so we need to remember that though we might be alone in the sense of being separated from other believers and unable to fellowship with them like we're used to doing, the Holy Spirit is never far from us. That he's always there with us to encourage us, to enlighten the scriptures, and to help us finish that race. All right, would you turn back now to Galatians 6, 9 as we move into our second section, and that's courage. So continue reading in Galatians 6, 9, and let us not grow weary. Those words grow weary are what we're going to focus on here. We're to not grow weary. We'd have courage. But these words grow weary, they have the following definitions: to turn out to be a coward, to lose one's courage, to be faint-hearted in the face of a trial or difficulty, to be slothful in duty. And perhaps the ultimate example of growing weary, of turning out to be a coward, takes place in the book of Numbers. So will you turn to the book of Numbers for just a minute? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, the fourth book of Moses there, the fourth book of the Bible. In Numbers chapter 13, we're going to look at verses 23 through 33. And what we have here is the children of Israel, they've escaped from Egypt. Moses has let them out. They've gone through the Red Sea and they've gone to Mount Sinai. And now it's time to go into the Promised Land. But we're going to see that they're going to grow weary. They're going to turn out to be cowards. Starting in verse 23 of Numbers 13, it says, "When they came to the valley of Eshcol, there they cut down a branch of one with one cluster of grapes and carried it between two of them on a pole. And they also brought some of the pomegranates and figs." And so these are the spies, the 12 spies that have been sent into the land. It says, "The place was called the Valley of Eshcol because of the cluster which the men of Israel cut down there. And they returned from spying out the land after 40 days. Now when they departed and came back to Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh, they brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told him and said, 'We went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit.'" And so that's a good start. That's exactly what the Lord said. It was a land of flowing of milk and honey, a fruitful land, everything great so far, but it turns badly in verse 28. "Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south. The Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites dwell in the mountains. The Canaanites dwell by the sea and along the banks of the Jordan." And so they're complaining about all the things. They're chickening out, if you will. It's just too much. It's too big. There's too much going on there. But notice we have someone who is not growing weary. Verse 30, "Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, 'Let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it.'" So Caleb said, "Let's do this. Let's take hold of God's promise." Verse 31, "But the men who had gone up with him said, 'We are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we.'" And they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, "The land through which we have gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants, and the people whom we saw in it are men of great stature. And we saw the giants, the descendants of Anak, came from the giants, and we were like grasshoppers in our sight, our own sight, so we were in their sight. And so the focus is really on themselves and what they can do. They've totally forgotten about the Lord and what the Lord can do. And so we know the bad consequences of what happened. That generation did not enter to the promised land. Only Joshua and Caleb, the faithful of that generation, were able to go in. But even they had to wander around for 40 years with the rest of the Israelites. And so it's vital that as we think about not growing weary, about not losing heart, that we would not be like those 10 unfaithful spies, but instead we would follow the example of Joshua and Caleb. And that's easy to say, but how can we display Joshua and Caleb's type of courage in the midst of the difficulties of this life, in the midst of the challenges that we're facing right here, right now? Well, again, it's through the teamwork with the Holy Spirit. And so to see this truth in action, would you turn back to your New Testament? This time, let's turn to Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4, verses 23 through 31. As you're turning there to Acts chapter 4, Peter and John had been arrested, and they kind of made a habit of that during their time there, as we read about them in the book of Acts. But in Acts 4, starting in verse 23, it says, "And being let go, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. So when they heard that, they raised their voice to God with one accord and said, 'Lord, you are God, who made heaven and earth and sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of your servant David have said, why did the nations rage and the people plot vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For truly against his holy servant, your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, were gathered together to do whatever your hand and your promise determined before to be done.'" Here it is, verse 29. "Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word." I love this. Instead of growing weary, instead of chickening out, instead of losing heart, Peter and John, the rest of the disciples, say, "Lord, give us a power to keep doing the very thing that got us arrested. Let us, in the midst of this difficulty, in the midst of this challenge, let's keep doing it." And then he says, verse 30, "By stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus." And when they had prayed, the place where they were all assembled together was shaken. Notice, "And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness." As they have the Holy Spirit fills them, they're able to continue on and to press forward and to keep going in the midst of this difficult and challenging time. And so for more on this courage given by the Holy Spirit, would you turn now a little bit forward in Acts to Acts chapter 20? Let's look at Acts chapter 20, looking at verses 17 through 24. This is a kind of a real heartbreaking moment here as Paul is on his way to Jerusalem and he's meeting with the Ephesian elders and he's pouring out his heart to them and he wants them to be courageous in difficult times. Verse 17 of Acts 20. It says, "From Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called for the elders of the church. And when they had come to him, he said to them, 'You know, from the first day that I came to Asia, in what manner I always lived among you, serving the Lord with all humility, with many tears and trials, which happened to me by the plotting of the Jews, how I kept back nothing that was helpful, but proclaimed it to you and taught you publicly from house to house, testifying to Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And see, now I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me." Now I love this, verse 24. "But none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy, and the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God." And so we have this Paul and his power in the Holy Spirit to move forward is because he wasn't focused on the me. He was focused on the us. He was focused on doing what the Lord called him to do. And the big takeaway as we kind of think about all that's in this section is this: not growing weary, that choice to not grow weary, is an active decision to be courageous, not in your power, not in my power, but in the power of the Holy Spirit. That we need to depend on the person of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, to empower us, to encourage us to keep running the race, because you and I can't do that. As you and I just scroll the news and kind of see the next bad thing that happens and, you know, the uncertainty economically and everything else, we are going to become discouraged. But when we depend on the person of the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, to encourage us and empower us, we're going to be able to keep running the race and not grow weary. All right, let's go back now to Galatians 6:9 as we move into our third section, and that's focus. We read here, and let us not grow weary, notice, while doing good. You know, in the Ironman triathlon, the athlete must focus on swimming, must focus on biking, and must focus on running, and likewise, the faithful Christian must also focus. But the believer's focus is not on swimming or biking or running. The believer's focus is on doing good. And so doing good is the Christian's calling in life. But that seems like too broad of a term. What exactly does it mean to be doing good? Well, the word doing there, it speaks of a continuing action. This doing, it's a constant. It's an everyday thing. And then the good means to do well or to do virtuously. Well, practically speaking, we can divide up our focus of doing good into two parts: doing good generally and doing good specifically. So what does it mean to do good generally? What does it mean to do good specifically? First of all, we have doing good generally. In other words, in general, what is it that God considers doing good? Well, to answer this question, let's turn and see what the Lord Jesus said in Matthew chapter 22. So turn there in your Bibles a little bit to Matthew chapter 22, verses 36 through 40 is where we'll be looking. So Matthew 22, verse 36 here, we have an individual comes up to Jesus, says, "Teacher, what is the great commandment in the law?" And Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." And so what Jesus is saying here is, you know, this greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And he says, the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. And so generally, when we think about what does it mean to do good generally, what does it mean to keep on doing good, we can really funnel it into two simple categories, loving God and loving others. As you look at the Ten Commandments, all the Ten Commandments can be separated into that, into loving God and to loving others. And so the warning for us here as we think about what's the application is that we often grow weary of running the race because we stop doing good. We stop doing good. We become focused on something else instead of focusing on loving God and loving others. And we get complicated and we kind of go in a bunch of different directions. We stop doing good. We lose focus. And what happens? Our courage begins to fade and we become untrustworthy teammates. We're not doing our part. So when you say, well, the Lord doesn't want me to grow weary in doing good, and the power of the Spirit, what does it mean to do good? Well, focus on loving God and loving others. And Jesus says, what does it mean to love God? Well, you love God by obeying his commandments, just doing what he said. Well, how do I love others? You love others by doing what's in their best interest. You do good for others by actually leaving some toilet paper for them at the store. You do those kind of things. We focus on others. So that's doing good generally. Let's talk about doing good specifically. Doing good specifically is doing that thing that God has specifically called you and gifted you to do. What is that he's empowered you, gifted you to do? What is it the Holy Spirit has given you gifts to do? The question is, what is that specific good that God has called you to do? You know, for some in this fellowship, it's ushering or it's greeting, it's teaching children, it's working, you know, on the worship team or the slides or sound or whatever the case may be. One of the specific good God's called me to is to teach the Bible. This is an interesting way to do it. I've never done it just like this before, but that's what the circumstances are called for. But your specific doing good, maybe it's raising kids, or maybe it's selling cars, maybe it's protecting or serving, maybe it's ministering to those who are ill. What is that specific good God has called you to do? Do that. Keep focused on that thing. Keep doing that good in the power of the Holy Spirit. All right, let's turn back now to Galatians 6:9 as we move into our fourth section, and that's patience. Patience, and probably this is my least favorite part of this verse here. It says, and let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season. This is the part of the verse where we begin to see the farming metaphor once again, this due season here. This, the word for that Paul uses here, it could be translated because. And so this word ties the first half of the verse to the second half of the verse. That word for is a connector or a hinge. Notice, and let us not grow weary while doing good, for or because in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Now this phrase due season here, it means appointed time, a set time, a certain season, a fixed or definite time or season. So just as physical crops have a definite season of growing and of being harvested, so spiritual crops have a definite seasons of growing and harvesting. And personally, I'll be quite honest, I have a bit of a problem with this. My frustration results from the fact that I have no idea when that due season is. You see, a farmer can purchase a farmer's almanac that tells him when to plant and then when he can expect to reap. But I have been unable to find a God's almanac that lets me know when the harvest is coming. And as a result, I don't know when the due season is. And because God does not tell us when the due season is, if we're to be faithful, we must remain patient. Just keep planting those seeds. Just keep watering them and keep waiting patiently for due season. However, this waiting can be very difficult because we live in a fast food, instant popcorn, give me what I want when I want it society. And so patience is such a difficult thing to have waiting for this due season. And I think it unlikely that I'm the only one who struggles with impatience. We need to answer that question. How do we remain patient? We find the answer as we move into our next section, and that's promise. Our fifth section is promise. Notice, and let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap. So we can be patient because we have a promise. For in due season we shall reap. We have God's promise that we shall reap the fruit of our labors, that we will receive a reward. The reaping will make all the intensive labor worthwhile. Everything that we've done, everything we've put into it, all the blood, sweat, and tears for what God has called us to do, all the general good and the specific good will all be worth it when we reap. And this promise here in Galatians 6:9 is so valuable because it guarantees a spiritual harvest. When you think about the physical harvest as a farmer plants, well, that harvest is always in doubt. There's a possibility of flooding or of drought. There's a possibility of hail or pests or all kinds of things. But what we have here is a promise. And I love this, and it ties into what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. He says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. And so keep running that race, keep working that field, because we have the Lord's promise that we will reap and that we will be rewarded. Now, with that said, we cannot leave off the end of this verse. And this moves us to our final section, that's endurance. Notice, and let us grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap. Notice, if we do not lose heart. If we do not lose heart. Just as you cannot win the Ironman triathlon if you don't finish, so you can't reap that full harvest of what God has for you if you quit on your crop. And so this promise of a full harvest, of this full reaping, is conditional. And the condition is enduring. We must endure if we are to reap. So as we think about this conditional promise, it's worth noting that the most famous verse of the Bible also contains a conditional promise. Of course, that most famous verse in the Bible is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Notice that condition. Whoever believes in him. That promise is open to all, but only those who believe in the Lord Jesus can receive that. And so if you're a person who's watching this and you have not yet trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ for your salvation, I would encourage you that John 3:16 is for you. That you can receive eternal life by believing on him. That the Lord Jesus has paid for your sins and that he's welcomed you into eternal life. So we have that conditional promise. And so it is for us in Galatians 6:9 and not losing heart of wanting to receive that fullness of all that God has for us, that full crop, that full reaping, we must endure. Notice this phrase that Paul uses again in Galatians 6:9, this lose heart. It means to be weary. To be exhausted, to faint. This losing heart is a picture of a farmer who's broken up the ground. He's planted the seeds, he's watered the field, but in the heat of summer, he quits on his crop. He leaves his field and he never reaps the crop. He never harvests. And so it's kind of like that Ironman triathlete who he competes in the swimming part and the biking portion, but he quits during the run. He just has had enough. And so as we think about this and as we think about this desire and to finish the race that we have been called to run, to reap the fullness of that crop that the Lord wants us to reap, well, how can we endure? How can we endure as believers? How can we avoid losing heart? Well, to answer that question, I want to have you turn to one last scripture. Would you turn forward in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 12? I want to look at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. As you're turning there, Hebrews would be another great book to read during this time of social distancing and this time of kind of being isolated somewhat from other believers, because as you read about Hebrews was written to Jewish people who'd become believers but were thinking about quitting. They were thinking about going back to the old life because the persecution and difficulty was just too much. And so this book is really written as an encouragement, as an exhortation to keep running the race, to keep doing good, to finish to the end. And so here in Hebrews 12, verses 1 through 3, we see how we can endure. We read, "Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses," remember that cloud of witnesses is that hall of faith in Hebrews 11, those people who are such great examples of what it means to follow the Lord. Says, so we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. Now, it may seem elementary. It may seem like, okay, this is what pastors always say. But it remains true that we endure by keeping our eyes on the Lord Jesus. Not by keeping our eyes on the news, on the latest proclamation from government officials, or for this prognostication of what's going to happen with what's, you know, going on in our world today. But by keeping our gaze firmly affixed upon the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit indwelling us, that's what he's going to do. He's going to encourage us to keep our eyes on the Lord Jesus, because the Lord Jesus is our motivation. He's our example. He's the reason why we run the race. He's the reason why we work the field. He's the one who's commissioned us and put us out there. And so I'd encourage you in this time, as you have some downtime, to really focus back on the Lord. Read the Gospels again. Focus on the Lord Jesus and remember he's the one who saved you. He's the one who drew you by his Spirit. He's the one who sent the Holy Spirit to indwell us and infill us. And he's the one we're to keep looking to so we can keep running this race, enduring until the end. You see, ultimately, we will endure not as we focus on a purpose or on a principle, but as we focus on a person. The person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with that said, we're going to wrap up our time together, and I hope you have been encouraged to keep running the race. I hope I have been encouraged to keep running the race, to keep doing good, knowing that you and I will reap in due season. And my prayer is that you and I will turn to Galatians 6:9 in our times of discouragement, and remember that the Christian life is not lived in isolation, but that you and I are teammates with fellow Christians and with the Holy Spirit. And again, it's going to be an extra little challenge right now of reaching out to fellow Christians, but do it. Make the effort. Reach out through social media, through texting, whatever way to get a hold of fellow believers in this time. May we remember that we can live courageously through that continual empowering of the Holy Spirit. Though that we may feel weak and tired and worried, the Holy Spirit is not weak. He's not tired. He's not worried. He can give us that power we need to continue on. My hope is that we remain focused on doing good continuously, doing good generally, doing good specifically, loving God, loving others, doing what God's called us to do in this season, remaining patient, knowing that in due season we will reap a harvest, remembering that God promises to reward us as we endure to the end. And the way we endure to the end is we keep our eyes on the finish line. We keep our eyes on the Lord Jesus. It is true that we do not know how long our race will last. We don't know how long we're going to be expected to farm this field. But we do know that as we run this race, no matter how long it may be, we know who waits for us at the end. we know that when we get to him and we see his face, we feel his touch, we'll know that it was all worth it. So let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this time. Thank you for this opportunity to teach your word. Lord, we know that it's all for you, and that whether we're in a room filled with people or a room with just a couple, Lord, that you're present. I pray that this message would be an encouragement to people and would minister to them. I pray that you be with us in the uncertainty of these days, and that you would fill us afresh with your spirit. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
You are not a God.